Open the word of truth to Galatians chapter 1, please. We continue our study in verse 6. Every believer is a priest, and every believer priest has the privilege of personally and privately preparing himself for the study of the Word of God, using rebound if necessary, bringing every thought into captivity of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Once again, Heavenly Father, it is a privilege and an honor to thank you for the Word of God and to prepare ourselves to study it. May God the Holy Spirit glorify God the Son, cause believers to grow and advance spiritually, the place where they may truly magnify the Lord Jesus Christ and open the window that glorifies Him in each life. I ask in Jesus' name, amen. All right, in Galatians chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, Paul has drawn the battle lines, I should say. Two things are going to be the major subject that he's going to have to deal with in the major body of the epistle, which begins in verse 11. And the first has to do with, as it is here, his apostleship, or his authority over that church. And that's how he begins in chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle, sent not from men nor by men, but by Jesus Christ, even by God the Father, who raised him from the dead. So we have his apostleship being the first thing that he deals with. The second area of battle line is going to be the work of our Lord Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And that is brought out in the passage, speaking of grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Now, ordinarily, the next thing after the basic introduction, you would expect to find some word of commendation. And as we pointed out in the introduction to the study of Galatians, there's no such thing here. Paul has nothing to commend this church about. As a matter of fact, he launches into a severe criticism. And that criticism begins with the words, "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to another gospel." Lutheran scholar Lenski writes these interesting words, and when he refers to Melanchthonian, he's talking about Luther's associate Melanchthon. Luther was much more vociferous. He was not as cultured. He was he often flew off the handle. Melanchthon, who was the real theologian of the Lutheran Reformation, was his right hand, and he was the conciliatory type. He was the type that would like smooth things over. He tried to smooth things over with the papacy, and it never worked out. But the reference you would expect, perhaps a Lutheran scholar to refer to Lutheranism, and he does from time to time quote from Luther as well as others. But he says this: the very first paragraph is stunning. Soft Melanchthonian methods are not in place. Heroic measures are demanded. For here, there's no error in life. The heart of Christendom is assailed. The foe is deadly. A cancer threatens the vitals. Palliatives, the word means to moderate the intensity of something, palliatives would be a fatal mistake. The remedy must destroy the ailment to the very roots. And he's absolutely right. This is no place to talk softly or to say, now let's sit down and jawbone on this thing, as the Congress and the new president are going to jawbone together with the remaining Republicans and come up with some kind of consensus. With the emphasis on his absolute authority already recorded, the apostle is going to measure his words very, very carefully. Not that all scripture should not be handled this way. It should. All scripture should be dealt with word by word, because all words are important. But especially here, every word that is used by the apostle Paul is extremely important, because he has measured his words carefully. He has measured them exactly. He has weighed them. And every statement that he makes is deliberate and to the point. He knows what he's talking about. He's been completely informed. And he's ready to take action with this group of people. And he begins with the statement, I am astonished. We're using the New International as our base. This is the present active indicative form of the Greek verb thaumazo. Thaumazo. Thaumazo means to wonder at, to marvel at something. It is a word of astonishment. The adjective, the cognitive adjective, means wonderful, marvelous. Now, this is not as strong a word as you might expect Paul to use. But the reason is he's tempering his judgment with grace. This is a mild word. Paul is looking at the defection of the Galatian church, and he is saying, I am astonished because I expected better things of you. You have let me down. I thought that you would go on to greater heights, but you have disappointed me. Certainly not lived up to what I thought you should do. The present tense is the present tense of continuous action at the present time. Paul is in a state of astonishment at this time. He gets the word in the report of what is happening at Galatia, and he is in a state of astonishment. John Eady says of the use of the word, he discloses in a moment the feeling of disappointment which could not repress or modify. He shows surprise not unmingled with anger and sorrow. The result had not been as he'd fondly anticipated. Nay, it was so contrary to previous manifestations on which he seems to have trusted that his censure and chagrin are expressed by his amazement. Rebuke lurks under his surprise. The verb often, from the context, gathers into itself the ethical notion of what is culpable or blamable. Surprise, excited by what is the object of censure. So he uses the perfect word that shows amazement, surprise, astonishment, and yet disappointment. With the disappointment is the criticism, the correction, the concept of censure. And so Paul is astonished. The active voice, of course, the subject produces the action of the verb, and the indicative mood is declarative for the reality of a dogmatic statement. Then he adds these words, that you are so quickly. Now we have two adverbs here. The first looks like this in the Greek, and the second looks like this. Houtos, H-O-U-T-O-S, and takeos. The first means thus, in this way, under such circumstances, and takeos means quickly, speedily, hastily, shortly, or in considerable haste. The best translation is Dr. Wiest points out, readily, rashly, or quickly. It speaks of the rapidity with which the Galatians were turning away from Paul and his teaching of grace to the Judaizers and their teaching of works. And so the concept of readily or rapidly or rashly turning away. The idea is that there were false teachers. We don't want to ever forget that, and we'll deal with that, of course. There were false teachers, but there always have been and always will be false teachers. The culpability for apostasy does not lie with the false teachers. That is, the responsibility for turning away from truth does not lie with the false teachers. It lies with the individual believer who does not have the information or the courage to stand for truth. Now, the Apostle Paul has confronted false teachers, yes. But false teachers are always going to be around. It's how does the church respond to the false teachers? What is the attitude of these people toward the unscrupulous? A few years ago, and some of you will remember it, I'm sure, a new phrase became a part of the American vocabulary. During the time when the communism was on the rise around the world, there were a number of individuals in the United States of America who were naive, uninformed, simple-minded, some of them altruistic, looking for some kind of a solution to the problems of mankind. And while they were not dedicated communists, they were called fellow travelers. Some of you will remember that, I'm sure. Fellow travelers. And the idea was that whoever they were with, they went along with it. Reminds me of the country western song, If I Can't Be Near the Gal I Love, I'll Love the Gal I'm Near. You know, that old saw. But they were fickle. And Webster defines fickle as marked by lack of steadfastness, constancy, or stability given to erratic change. And here were people who were given to erratic change. Quickly, readily, rapidly, rashly. The Apostle Paul left, in came the Judaizers, and in just a moment of time, the Galatian people gave a ready reception to false teachers. Now, Paul had been there long enough to establish them, and just as he had written, remember, to the Ephesian church, he says in Ephesians that God has given the gift of pastor-teacher to equip the saints, the believers, to do the work of the ministry. But he goes on to say, another purpose for teaching doctrine was so that believers would be no longer children. But he describes the characteristic of children then as tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Or what? Unstable. Instability is the characteristic of the child. And you know, this is true, but not only of Galatia. You stop to think. The problem was true at Corinth. The problem was true in Colossae. The problem was addressed by the Apostle John. He writes in 1 John 2:18, "Dear children, this is the last hour, and as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have already come." And that's why he says in chapter 3, verse 7, "Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray." As a matter of fact, the passage which says you do not need to have anyone teach you these things has nothing to do with the fact that you don't need a pastor teacher. The subject is false teachers. You don't need false teachers. You don't need to have them around. That's why eventually he writes, as I've already pointed out in 2 John, "Do not receive these people into your home. Do not bid them Godspeed," which are both are idioms for giving them a ready acceptance of their message. Now, it's amazing to me how many believers are so readily removed from truth. If all somebody has to do is to come along with an impressive personality, particularly if there's a lot of humor in that personality. They follow. They take the bait, hook, line, and sinker. I have indicated before my own chagrin at what has happened at Dallas Seminary, and it's a tragedy to me. I saw it years ago. Dr. Chafer founded Dallas Seminary for the purpose of zeroing in on the original languages of Scripture, which is the reason that some of the men in the ICE movement have determined to start their own seminary, and which is the reason why Glenn Carnegie has started the Cascades Seminary of Biblical Languages. It only teaches three things: Greek, Hebrew, and what we call eisegesis. Nothing else. And what happened a number of years ago is a very outstanding teacher, a very charismatic type teacher, Howard Hendricks, came to the seminary and became the head of the Christian Education Department. That was the beginning of the end as far as Dallas Seminary is concerned. He is the most a charming speaker I have ever heard. He has you laughing one moment and crying the next. He plies your emotions and your intellect, and he is a master at it. He has some good points, but the failure is that the emphasis in the seminary moved away from the original languages to strong emphasis on Christian education. And there is a place for Christian education, but you have to stop and realize that there is no biblical mandate for Christian education. There is no place in the Bible that sets up a Christian education program for any place in the church. That responsibility is given to the parents Now, there's not to say that if the church is to communicate doctrine, that it shouldn't communicate doctrine to boys and girls on a level that they understand. That is necessary. That's why we call it prep school here. And I have to be constantly reminding the people in prep school that they are preparing those students to come into this class. And I remind the young people at the same time, the end result is not to come to prep school, but the end result is so that you would be prepared to come into this class, because it is in this class where you receive the meat of the Word of God for spiritual growth. And God has not ordained teachers of the gospel. He has ordained pastor teachers. That's the only authorized gift that God has provided for the communication of doctrine to the saints. Which is not to say that the others are prohibited. Others are utilizing spiritual gifts that they have, but for the purpose of preparing them that they may sit under the pastor teacher of the local church, who is the communicator of Bible doctrine. And so this is very, very important to understand. Christian education is an appendage. And then some of their number who graduated with the original languages of Scripture and with emphasis in Christian education, went on to the field of counseling. And the Meyer Minerth Clinic is the outgrowth of that. These two doctors these two men went on to get additional doctorates, as well as in the field of philosophy, in the field of medicine. One is a psychiatrist, and in psychology, which is related, and they formed the Meyer Minerth Clinic. Today, this is one of the largest mental health, I hate that term, but I don't know how else to designate it, clinics in the country. And it has left a tremendous influence over Dallas Seminary. And we say, well, it isn't so bad. It is, if you remember, beloved, that early on in this century, that the great schools of Yale and Harvard were divinity schools. They were seminaries. And if you ever want to read an interesting biography, you read the story of J. Gresham Machen, one of the great fundamental theologians of a bygone era, who was so strongly indoctrinated in Scripture and in the inerrancy of the Word of God. And he fought the early battles against the infiltration of liberalism in those schools. The great missionary Borden, in another biography, Borden of Yale, turned out a man who was from the great Borden Milk family, but who was dedicated more to the preaching of the gospel around the world than he was to making money, so that one day he and his friend were coming out of a home in Egypt, and a very fashionable, up-to-date automobile drove by, and Borden turned to his friend and said, "Boy, I wish I had one of those." And the man turned to him and said, you could afford to buy 100 of those." He said, "That's not my life. My life is today," and he gave his life, actually, as a young man in Egypt for the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But see, all of the great seminaries began as bastions of fundamentalism. But somewhere along the line, compromise was made in order for them to allow someone else to come in and to propagate error. I understand that there's a church in our town who took a large number in from another church that had a split. And these people were welcomed with open arms, though there was a slight variation in theology. Now, however, a couple of years have gone by, and the people who were taken in with their deviant theology are now in a position to be on boards. Now they're beginning to exert their own their own interests in propagating the deviant theology. And this second church is now on the verge of having a split, if it hasn't already taken place, among the people who were originally there with their theology, and the deviant people who come in with their deviant theology now wanting to assert their authority and taking over the church, now splitting that church down the middle because they had infiltrated this church. But it's amazing how many people fall for these things. And under the guise of loving the brethren, accept anything, you see. Or somebody who has a doctor before their name or a lot of letters afterwards seem to impress believers. And all they have to do is come along with a mouthful of teeth and people will swallow whatever they have to say. The great tragedy here is that this isn't a falsehood about something of little import. It's the heart of the truth that's at stake. For what he is going to say in these next verses, as you see me exegete it, or hear me exegete it, you will hear him say this, that they're being taken away, they are defecting to another gospel, but that's not a gospel. That's not the gospel. You can't have the gospel because of the Greek words being full. There is no such thing as a false gospel. Can't be. Why? Gospel means good news. How can there be false good news? I mean, that's an impossibility. It's just like you can't have Christian Science. You can't be like that. It doesn't work. Well, it's an amazing thing. And the point is, the gospel is the power of God to salvation. Anything else leads to hell, and that's not good news. But why? Why in the world are these people so ready to receive false teaching? What is it that says that something new and different is necessary? Many a pastor has fallen into the trap of the congregation which is demanding something new and different. Here's a word for you. If you haven't ever learned it, learn it now. A dilettante. Now, you know what a debutante is. What's a dilettante? A dilettante is one who's always looking for something new and hopping from thing to thing, from boyfriend to boyfriend, or man to man, or woman to woman, or hobby to hobby, or subject to subject, whatever it may be. And the church is filled with dilettantes. A number of years ago, during the early years of the century, the Bible Conference movement provided a very interesting outlet for these dilettantes, but they were all fundamentalists. They moved from one to another. And they'd have big conference grounds, such as Winona Lake. When we went by there this summer, I noticed that the Billy Sunday Tabernacle is now no longer. It's been torn down. That doesn't say much to a lot of people, but many of us will go back to remember. Winona Lake was founded to provide a place for Chicagoans to hop on the train and to come out there to hear some of the greatest Bible teachers in the country, who would come there and speak in this huge tabernacle, which had sawdust on the floor, hard pine seats that were just benches, and it was filled. As great speakers from all over the country would come and speak there. and they were fundamentalists. Well, the days have changed, and things have changed, and the first thing they did was added an air-conditioned auditorium because people were tired. The new generations didn't want to sit in that hot place, and they didn't like the sawdust on the floor, and they didn't like the hard benches. And although I don't think the chairs they've got are much improvement, but anyway, the point is the times have changed, and the auditorium that they built is 1/4 the size, if it's that large, of the old Billy Sunday Tabernacle. Named after one who did speak at that tabernacle years and years ago. But names like Billy Sunday and Paul Rader, who founded the Gospel Temple here in Fort Wayne, and others are great speakers who traveled across the country speaking. They got to meet these folks and to hear them, and at that time it wasn't so bad. But you see, now we have these dilettantes that are propagating themselves by means of the electronic medium, and they're propagating false teaching and false doctrine, and it's tragic. Why it happens can only be attributed to the old sin nature and the arrogance of the individual. So Paul says, I am absolutely amazed that you so readily or so rashly, now we have the verb, are deserting. We have here the present, passive, pardon me, middle, they're both the same, indicative from this Greek word. M-E-T-A. T-I-T-H-E-M-I. Meta means to change. And tithemi, T-I-T-H-E-M-I, means to place or to put. So it means to transpose two things, to put one thing in the place of another. It was used in the classical Greek for a turncoat or a traitor. It has the idea of one altering his opinion and becoming of another mind. It was also used of desertion or revolt, and frequently of a change of religion, philosophy, or morals. This is called a progressive present tense, for an action in the state of progress, something which is currently going on. The passive and the middle voice both have the same form here, so it leaves the interpreter with the opportunity and the responsibility of making the proper decision. For the passive voice would say that the subject receives the action of the verb. The middle voice would say that the subject participates in the action of the verb. Now, passive voice would say that they received removal, and so we have to discount that as not being the real meaning at all. Here is the fact that they were responsible themselves. And the middle voice is reflexive. They themselves were responsible for this desertion, this defection. And the indicative mood is declarative for the reality of the circumstance or the situation. The present tense also indicates that their defection was not yet complete. And the word we will use is the word defect. I think it's more familiar to us today, since we've heard about people from one or another, a country defecting to another, which is a change of opinion to replace one with another. We'll use the term defection for the best translation that I think we can come up with. I'm absolutely amazed that you so readily, so rashly are defecting from the one who called you. Now, called is the aorist participle from a friend that we are well acquainted with, kaleo, K-A-L-E-O. Remember that the action of the aorist participle precedes the action of the main verb. And before you can defect to something else, you have to be called to the first thing. And this refers, in the aorist tense, to the point of time that they believed the gospel as it was communicated to them, became born-again Christians. So they believed on Christ, and they became believers, and this precedes their defection, obviously. And so this is a revelation of the fact that these are believers, and therefore we know they can't lose their salvation. They're not going into hell, but they are believers who received God's gracious invitation from God the Holy Spirit to faith in Christ, and so exhaled faith and became a part of those who inherited the eternal salvation. They're described in Romans 8, 29 and 30 as those whom he foreknew, he also called, and those he called, he declared righteous or justified. Romans 9, 24, he called us not only from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles. 1 Corinthians 1, 9, God who also has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, is faithful. And so we recognize that they were called. And they were called by means of the grace of Christ, indicating again that it was unearned and undeserved. It was a response to the move of God. And so they are removed. And then we have the preposition of ultimate source, which looks like this. Omicron. A-P-O, apo, which is the preposition of ultimate source. And the ultimate source is the God who called them. So the translation, I am absolutely amazed that you so readily, so rashly are defecting from the one who called you by the grace of Christ. Again, Lenski has an interesting paragraph that I think is worth sharing. He says, nothing in the world should ever make the Galatians change away from him who called them in grace and at the price of his death delivered them from this present world which was wicked and doomed. They should have resisted the most powerful and the most persistent efforts to the last breath. Yet, they are quickly beginning their apostasy. Paul might have used a stronger word than I marvel. He names the deadly thing the Galatians had begun to do to change away from Christ. The Galatians themselves would disavow this. They intended to stay with Christ. The Judaizers themselves taught Christ, yea, they came as genuine apostles of Christ. Why, the Galatians were now getting Christ better than they ever got him. Any plea of that kind is silenced by the next phrase. No, it's to a different gospel, which is not even another, but so different so as to be no gospel at all. I think the thing he pointed out there is worth noticing. You see, the point is that he makes is that they would probably never admit that they were leaving Christ, but they are getting closer to God. Now I want to be the one to warn you, folks. If you have not already, sooner or later, you're going to run across some so-called super-spiritual Christian who's going to come to you and say, are you as close to the Lord as you want to be? Now, you know, in your humility, you're not going to say, oh, yes, I am. In your humility, you're going to say, well, no, I guess. Let me tell you how you can get closer to God. You're saved by grace, yes. But you see, if you want to really get close to God, let me tell you what you have to do. You have to speak in tongues. That is real devotion to God. Or, heck, as the Galatian legalizers were saying, you want to get close to God? Then you start obeying the Mosaic law. That will show God how much you love Him. You'll be obedient to the law. And here they sit and they say, well, I suppose he's right. I mean, after all, if I do everything I can, if I add to this grace great works of mine, certainly God's going to be more pleased with me, isn't he? Certainly God's going to say, I appreciate that. Not only are you saved by grace, but now you're giving every bit of your effort for me. Ah, that's great. Wonderful. Go to it, boy. That sounds logical, doesn't it, folks? It sounds exactly like what they were telling the Galatians. You see, they come along insidiously hitting believers who don't understand the finished work of Christ and the grace of God. Always, 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 whenever you find somebody who wants to add something, it's an error in the finished work of Christ and or the concepts of what grace is all about. And in salvation, remember I've traced it all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Yea, hath God said, question, 2 Corinthians 11:3, Paul writes to the Corinthians, says, but I am afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your simple and pure devotion to Christ. Simple and pure devotion to Christ. In that same chapter, he describes these people. They don't come with a big sign across the front that says, I'm a teacher, false teacher. They don't say, I'm sent by Satan. But, you know, chapter 11 of 2 Corinthians, verses 13 to 15 says, for such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an apostle or as an angel of light. It's not surprising then if his servants masquerade as servants of light. That's why the Apostle Paul warned, and we'll talk about these in a moment when we talk about their false message, but he warned in Acts 20, 28 to 31, keep to the pastors of the churches at Ephesus. Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. For I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after themselves. Be on your guard. And the more you study the New Testament and see the insidious infiltration that they had, it seems every writer had problems with them. Peter had his problems with these false teachers that came in. Paul had his problems. John had his problems. In fact, John says in 1 John 4:1, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Because many prophets, he's talking about false prophets, have gone out into the world. And then he lists the test as faithfulness to the attitude toward the incarnate person of God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The test of orthodoxy. We will be introduced to another word But orthodoxy, as opposed to heterodoxy. We shall see these, but ortho is straight. Orthodontist, straighten your teeth. Orthopedic, straighten your spine. But this is straight doctrine. Heteros is different doctrine. And you've got to decide whether it's orthodoxy or heterodoxy. And you've got to know the tests by which you can place alongside the spirits to determine whether they are of Christ or whether they are not. And we'll get into that a little bit more when we come to their message in the last part of the sixth verse. I am absolutely amazed that you so readily, so rashly are defecting from the one who called you by the grace of Christ to another gospel. Now thank you, loving Father, for our study thus far. May God the Holy Spirit help us to be forewarned about the enemies of our souls, that we may not be taken in by these false teachers who are so prominent in this day and age as they were even in Paul's day, that we may remain pure and simple in our devotion to our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray. Amen.